Today on Waking Up in America, I'm talking to Glennon Doyle Melton, the author of New York Times best-selling memoir, Carry On Warrior, and founder of MamaStory.com, blog and online community that connects hundreds of thousands of followers. Glennon is a powerful truth teller and hope spreader who writes and speaks about marriage, motherhood, faith, addiction, recovery, and connection. I'm Tai Chi. At 19, I was a superstar and I was lost inside. I left it all behind, switched continents, and started all over. Years later, I found myself lost again, this time in the American dream. This is a story about awakening, about living the life you were created for, about going inward and discovering the joyous and purposeful person you and I are both meant to be. This is Waking Up in America. What wakes you up? What makes you feel awakened, excited to be, to show up, to live who you are? For me, books are one big inspiration tool that wakes me up. Even not just from emotional numbness or from a routine, but also from, you know, physical sleep. If I fall, often I would fall asleep with reading a really interesting book, and then the first thing that when I open my eyes, I reach for the book and I want to continue reading. One of those books I woke up with this morning is Carry On Warrior by Glennon Doyle Melton. A few weeks ago, a friend of mine, Ken Freed, from Naples, Florida, who is a health and wellness coach, was giving free hugs at the local market and ran into Glennon. And immediately, Ken sent me her links to her website, MamaStory.com. And I read everything on the website and watched every video. I love TEDx talks. And Glennon did an amazing TEDx talk in which she talks about lessons she learned from the mental hospital. Glennon is an amazingly open and vulnerable and disarming force, beautiful force in our world, who quotes Brené Brown in the TEDx quote when she says, "Courage is to tell the story of who you are with your whole heart." I just love that. And then as I watched the TEDx talk, you know, she said something that I said in one of these episodes, and I had my own experience of it coming from a different country. She says that, you know, we are as children taught that the only appropriate answer to the question, "How are you?" is, "I'm fine." Well, I learned that, you know, as an adult when I came to America. But, and I wrote a song about it. And so a few days later, when I went to meet Glennon and at her sold-out event here in Nashville, I was so excited to share with her my song. I saw you at the art show, you looked and smiled at me. You asked how I was doing, but you really didn't want to hear what I had to say, 'cause I'm not gonna lie. Not gonna smile and say I'm fine.
No, sister.
Well, isn't it true?
It's so true. It's so true. I'm not gonna say I'm fine. Oh, I love it.
So tell me, in your story, all right, you know, this show, Waking Up in America, is really saying, look, people, let's not be in that numb state, mm-hmm. in that, like, half asleep. Mm-hmm. And you lived quite a chunk of your life under a cape?
Mm-hmm. Numb, yeah. So I became bulimic when I was 8 years old, which is super early. And my daughter's 8 now, and I look at her and think, how? As addictions do, when they're not healed, they just morphed into other things. So I became an alcoholic when I hit college. And then that changed into drugs and on. But I think what you said is right. I think that I've just always been a very sensitive human being, which is a beautiful, beautiful thing. But I didn't know it was a beautiful, beautiful thing. I didn't think it was okay to not be fine, right?
Yes.
So when I was 8 and not fine, I thought there was something wrong with me. And that's why I went to hide in addiction. Because I really think addiction is just a hiding place. Hide
yes.
from the world there. Now when I look at my life, I think I'm still exactly that same 8-year-old sensitive girl. I'm just, I finally said, you know what? I don't think there's anything wrong with being a feeling, hurting, crying, afraid, doubting human being.
Isn't it so sad how our culture makes us think that that's okay to be this perfect all the time? And, you know, I had my hiding place was music. And on the outside, I'm sure everybody thought that you were okay.
Oh, yeah. I was totally fine. I was hospitalized my senior year in high school. And back then they didn't have eating disorder clinics, so I went to a mental hospital. And I got out of the mental hospital, and the next day I was in a car in a homecoming parade, in homecoming court, with I had just been voted leading leader of my senior class. And I was like, I just got out of the mental hospital. Like, the two lives were so incredibly opposite. You know, I was so different on the outside than I was on the inside.
Yes, I totally relate, because here I was in my teenage years a superstar, you know, on the outside, like this girl that has everything, and inside I was dying.
Right.
Wow. So okay, what was the moment? How did you feel when you broke?
Well, you know what? The moment that I quit, that I got sober, was a Mother's Day 12 years ago. I found out I was pregnant with my son. And, you know, I'm always careful to mention that it wasn't the first time that I'd been pregnant, because I don't want there to be any judgment around making different decisions around that. But for some reason, that moment just felt like, it really felt to me like an invitation, like the pregnancy test, just to come back to life. And so, I don't know, I just got off the bathroom floor, I went to my first meeting, and I just promised myself that I was going to try. Like, I was just going to try to live. And so I just promised myself I was going to do the next right thing. Just, I couldn't even do one day at a time, because I was so lost back then. So it was just the next right thing.
And when you say next right thing, what's right and what's wrong at that point?
Right. So at that point, I was so confused about how to live a sober life that the next right thing might be, I'm going to get dressed. Like, I'm serious. It was that, like, I'm going to get out of bed and I'm going to get dressed. And then what is the next right thing? I don't know. Step outside. Take a walk. Like, and then the little next right things, what happens is, the amazing thing that I found is, if you just keep doing the next right thing, one thing at a time, it adds up to this beautiful life.
Although you were dressing up before that moment and doing all those little things, it sounds like to me like now you're aware of doing, you got out of that numb state. Is that?
Yeah, I mean, because it didn't matter before. I mean, I was certainly acting, but I was also binging and purging six times a day. And I mean, the difference is I was dealing with my feelings, right? I mean, everything in the world, I have Be Still tattooed on my wrist, because I think that everything is dependent upon our ability to sit with discomfort and not numb it and not reject it and not use it to hurt other people and not, but just sit with pain. I think everything beautiful comes from there. And so I guess that's what I mean. I mean that I was able to function while not numbing out whatever feelings came.
Yeah.
Just not numbing them out. I mean, I think that lots of our problems, and not just, I was the kind of person that hurt myself, but I think a lot of the unkindness and the snarkiness and all of that, people hurting each other, also comes from the inability to be still with discomfort. I think that we feel something and we don't want to feel less than or shameful, so instead we put it on you, right?
Well, yes, deflect and we blame,
it.
Yes,
right,
absolutely.
Right.
And then also, you know, we numbing doesn't have to be, you know, it could be your job, your success, your
absolutely.
Marriage, your perfect marriage on the outside.
Yeah. I mean, I have a girlfriend who will tell you that her numbing is shopping. I mean, every time she starts to get itchy or confused, or she swipes it away with a credit card. I mean, my therapist calls it an easy button. Whatever you use as your easy button to deal with uncomfortable feelings, and you know it's an easy button when it doesn't help you in the long run. It actually hurts your long run.
Yeah.
But in the short run, it stops you from feeling. Easy buttons, mine was something dramatic, right? Mine was alcohol, mine was booze and drugs and all of that. But yes, easy buttons are often work and shopping. And I feel bad for those people because they don't hit rock bottom. Like, the beauty for me is that my numbing things were so dramatic that I had to hit rock bottom.
Right, you had that shift that was caused.
Like, I didn't have a choice.
Yes.
But you could numb by shopping throughout your whole life.
Right.
And never get to a place where you can be still.
Yes, and I think the worst, what you just said, it's like everybody around you supports that
right.
place that you're in.
That's right. Wow. Now it's because they don't necessarily see it as dangerous. But I think that anything that takes you out of discomfort is a problem. Because I think that, I do it all the time. Reality TV for me is my ease event. I'm like, I've had it. I need some freaking Kardashians. All right, life is too hard. Give me whatever. So that's my kind of numbing thing right now. And I'll take it. I think we all, reality is too hard to deal with 24/7, right?
Yes, yes.
But I do think we have to keep it in check. Because if we're, and phones now, oh my God, everybody uses their phone, Facebook, as a numbing.
Yes.
I think the second we start to get uncomfortable or sad or lonely, right?
Well, it's a great place to go, yes.
Yeah,
it is. It's easy, but yes.
It is, but yeah, yes. it's a numbing.
Yeah, no, I love how you found, in your writing, how strongly you really share this message of just be who you are. Don't strive, don't compete, don't try to prove anything, right? I just love that message. It's so important to say whatever it is that you are, I always say, I'm from Croatia, so I'm an immigrant. I love America. But I always wonder, whose American dream are you living? Your own or someone else's? Picture of the American dream.
Right. And you need to make sure that what you want, what your dream is internal and not from someone who's trying to sell you something, right? Because
yes.
I think we take on dreams from magazines and we take on like the American dream, having a house.
Oh, absolutely.
Who created that?
Absolutely.
The mortgage company.
Yeah.
Like God didn't say, and thou shalt have homes and thou shalt be happy. It was
right.
It was someone selling
right.
us something, right? And so
yeah.
we all... Now women dream, the dream is to look perfect and all, well that's because the, plastic surgeons are selling us that.
So right.
It really does take a little while to figure out, is my dream coming from inside of me or am I just buying the dreams of people who are selling things to me?
Yeah, so you right. encouraging people to be real, to be who they are, to admit your mess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because we all do live in this messy world, like you said, the book is Carry On Warrior, it's number one. New York Times seller.
Yeah,
I love it.
New York Times,
okay,
yeah.
So how do you feel that moment when you've been through, what your life is like, you even say you're both confident and humble. I love that how you put that all in. How does it feel then?
With the list thing? With the book doing well?
With success, with like your message, your voice, you going out there and reaching, obviously it's successful because it hit that place that we responded in.
Yeah, I just feel it extremely grateful. Mm-hmm. I just feel extremely grateful to have been given this opportunity to go out and connect with people, and that somehow my story and voice are encouraging other people. I feel grateful and I feel humble about it, and I feel scared, and I feel excited and scared.
That's beautiful.
I'm a little more scared.
Thank you so
yeah.
much. I am deeply grateful to you for all your work, for being who you are, for being
thank
a beautiful
you.
Soul.
Thank
you.
Thank you so much. You too. Can I squeeze you?
Oh,
thank you.
That night, as I experienced Glennon speak, I got into my car and I felt so good about myself. Not because I did something great, but because I felt encouraged to be okay with sitting with my own discomfort, in my own mess, not having to apologize, but really be still and allowing myself to work through it at my own pace without apologizing for who I am and for who I believe God made me to be. And as I was pulling out of the crowded parking lot, there must have been over 500 women there and few men. I thought, oh no, we all went home inspired to carry on with our beautiful, messy lives. What ripples were made that night. My challenge for you this week, check out momastery.com and read Glennon's book. That's what I'm going to do. That and squeeze my kids and have a glass of wine with Matthew.
World that you live in, I just wanna
Until next time, thank you for watching. The snow.